Hello friends and welcome back to the channel. In today's video, I'm setting up what I like to call a resurrection bowl. A tiny ecosystem built from insects and plants collected at a local pond here in Heilbronn, Germany. We'll go step by step, from finding the right swamp, to choosing substrate and hardscape, to arranging the plants. And then, of course, we'll meet the creatures that call this bowl home. From peaceful grazers to fierce little hunters. Let's jump right in. My journey started just past 6 a.m. here in Heilbronn. The city is still asleep. Streets are quiet and I'm heading out on my little expedition. I got some buckets, nets and all the gear I need. Today, I'm on my way to collect some materials to start a small ecosystem bowl at home. Saturday mornings are my favorite for doing this. No traffic, barely anyone around, just me and the sound of my footsteps through the city. Feels like the whole place belongs to you for a while. Curious to hear whether you guys are familiar with these streets here. If you are, please comment below. As I move out of the center, the concrete slowly gives way to trees and open space. It's a strange but beautiful transition, walking from stone and glass into something alive and breathing. This is my destination, a local park with ponds and small lakes. Perfect little pockets of life. And if you look closely, these places are full of hidden ecosystems, waiting to be explored. When you check the camera footage, and this is also something that was apparent from above, there's not much life in there, so I have to look for another, more vivid spot. And my journey takes me some 100 meters across this local pond, or should I say lake, to the small wooden footbridge here. And it is here where I actually spotted the perfect place to collect some dirt. Let's first have a look under the water. So you see, there's way more biological activity going on in this area, so I think this is the perfect spot to collect some dirt. And what I'm doing here is I'm gathering some pond soil, some water, and a few aquatic plants. Nothing too big, just enough to create a balanced little world in a jar. Each scoop is like a seed for a tiny universe. Might not see it at the moment. It just looks like dirt. But in a few minutes, we will have a thriving ecosystem made out of all of this dirt. Some of these creatures you can't even see with the naked eye, and some are rather big. I also want to dig into this huge algae patches here, because I assume that there's a lot of insects and crustaceans in there. I think there won't be any fish in there, just rather big insects. You can also see some of them swimming and jumping around in there at the moment, but nothing too big yet. Next thing we have to do is collect some more water. What I like to do when setting up these kind of projects is I like to take water from different spots in the local pond where I am, so I increase the chances of getting as much biodiversity as possible. And also, the smell test is something that I would advise you guys to do, because if you have very smelly things, usually your jar ecosystems might rot. And this is something you don't want to do if you have in your living room and if you want the animals to survive, right? One of the first plants I'm collecting today is bogbean, Menyanthes trifoliata. It's a wetland species that often grows in shallow water or along the muddy edges of ponds. The leaves are easy to recognize, three leaflets that almost look like a clover floating on the surface. In spring, it produces delicate white flowers that attract insects. But even when it's not in bloom, as it is today, bogbean plays an important role in pond ecosystems. It helps to oxygenate the water and provides shelter for small creatures. A
Another plant I'm taking today is yellow flag iris, or iris pseudacorus. This one is much more striking, tall, bright, and impossible to miss when it flowers. It thrives in the wet edges of lakes and streams, and its roots act like natural filters, cleaning the water as it grows. In a small jar ecosystem, it brings both structure and resilience. I'm only collecting a few specimens of each. It's important to be careful with plants like these. They're part of a bigger system here. Taking too much could disturb the balance, so I just gather what I need, leaving the rest to thrive in the pot. The centerpiece of this project is a simple glass bowl. My mom actually found it in the garbage, and today it's getting a second life. Before anything else, I give it a thorough clean. Just water and a clean cloth. No soaps or detergents. I want to make sure nothing harmful makes its way into the ecosystem. For the foundation, I'm using a layer of aquasoil that was left over from an old project. It's rich in nutrients and gives the plants a good base to root into. On top of that, I add a layer of white sand, also left over, this time from the tank project you can actually see in the background. By the way, if you want to see how that tank developed, there's a link on the top right corner you can check out. Before planting, I take a moment to flatten the sand bed. It's a small detail, but there's something almost therapeutic to it. Like working on a miniature Japanese sand garden. The surface becomes calm and level, a blank canvas for this little ecosystem. I begin with the yellow flag iris. In nature, this plant grows along riverbanks and wetlands, where its roots act like a living filter, pulling impurities from the water. In our small ecosystem here, it helps to stabilize the soil and keep the water clear over time. Tall leaves will also give some vertical structure, hinting at the feeling of a shoreline inside the bowl in my bathroom. Next comes the bogbean. This plant has a very different role. In the wild, its floating leaves shade shallow waters and give cover to small creatures like insects and amphibians. Even here, in a tiny glass bowl, it can create microhabitats, breaking up light, slowing down water movement, and providing surface area for microorganisms to settle on. To anchor the plants and add some visual balance, I place two larger rocks. They'll hold down the roots until the plants are firmly established, and at the same time, they create a sense of scale, like little boulders in a landscape. Before pouring in the pond water, I add a layer of plastic, just a plastic bag and a plastic lid. This way, the water won't disturb the sand or unroot the plants. It's a simple trick, but it makes all the difference in keeping the foundation intact. With the plants in place and everything secured, the stage is set. Next comes the most important step, introducing the pond water, and with it, the invisible life that will bring this miniature world to life. Days have passed since setting up this little ecosystem, and it has begun to settle into balance. Today, I'm adding tap water for the very first time. Room temperature, poured carefully. The fresh water stirs things up a bit, sending tiny clouds of sand and debris drifting through the bowl. And with that disturbance, one of the first true inhabitants reveals itself, a mayfly nymph. Mayflies are fascinating creatures. They belong to one of the most ancient groups of winged insects, relatives to dragonflies and damselflies. But unlike their cousins, mayflies spend almost their entire lives underwater, as nymphs, sometimes for a year or more, before transforming into the short-lived adults that give them their name. They're called mayflies because in many regions the adults emerge in large swarms during spring and early summer, often in May. In this aquatic stage, the nymph breathes through delicate gills along its abdomen. fanning them to move water and extract oxygen. It spends its days grazing, feeding on algae, plant debris, and the fine organic particles that collect on leaves and rocks. Their gills are delicate leaf-like structures that are located along their abdomen, and you will often see them fanning these gills to pump water across the surface. A behavior that helps them to extract oxygen from water, but in some mayfly nymph species, these movements also stir up fine food particles in the water, and I think that's also the case for this species if you look at it closely. There are over 3,000 species of mayflies worldwide, and their nymphs come in three broad ecological forms. Swimmers, which dart through the water column, clingers, which grip onto rocks and plants, and burrowers, which dig into mud and sand. The one in my bowl, that you can see here, is wandering freely over surfaces in search of food. You can also see a shot of one of the smaller mayfly nymphs here that is trying to eat some debris that is hanging on this plant. They are close relatives of dragonflies and damselflies, but unlike those predators, they are generally considered grazers. And here we see an interesting encounter. The mayfly nymph approaches a bladder snail. But when the snail suddenly swings its shell, the nymph backs away. It's a reminder that even in tiny ecosystems like this, there's a constant dance of interactions. Creatures negotiating space, testing boundaries, and responding to each other's movements. For now, the mayfly nymph is a quiet, almost hidden resident. But as this little world develops, its story will continue to unfold, alongside the plants, snails, and countless other tiny lives within the bowl. While the mayfly nymphs spend their whole existence underwater, another resident of this bowl lives a very different kind of life, the bladder snail. And unlike the delicate, gilled nymphs, these snails are air breeders. They belong to a group called pulmonates, meaning they have a simple lung that lets them take in oxygen directly from the air. This gives them a big advantage in environments where oxygen levels can drop. Because while mayfly nymphs would struggle, bladder snails can simply rise to the surface, extend their siphon, and take a gulp of air. This is a huge advantage in many ecosystems around the world where bladder snails are present, because bladder snails are originally from North America, but in 2025 they have spread through all continents worldwide, except for Antarctica, although I'm sure that maybe in the future we will even find them there. And bladder snails are surprisingly adventurous for such small creatures. So here you can see one climbing the bogbean leaf that is almost completely degraded. It's devouring what's left over, so it's filling a very similar ecological niche to the mayfly nymph. However, here you can see one of them climbing the central bogbean stem, several times its own size. It spends a few minutes exploring, grazing the thin biofilm, layers of bacteria and algae that coat the surface of the plant, and these snails are excellent scavengers, feeding not only on biofilm, but also on decaying leaves and leftover organic matter. In doing so, they recycle nutrients and help keep the system clean. Among all the creatures in this jar, the largest and perhaps the most fearsome is the dragonfly nymph. Unlike the grazing mayflies and snails, this is a true predator, a hunter perfectly adapted to life in the shadows of ponds and lakes. Dragonfly nymphs feed on almost anything they can overpower. Mosquito larvae, small crustaceans, worms, and even other insect nymphs. In larger ponds, they are capable of taking down tadpoles and even tiny fish. The key to their hunting success lies in a weapon unlike anything else in the insect world, the extendable lower jaw, called a labium. Normally, it is folded under the head like a hidden arm, but when the prey comes close, the nymph fires it forward
in a fraction of a second, grabbing the victim with hook pinchers at the tip and pulling it back into its sharp mandibles. This ambush lifestyle, powered by patience and explosive speed, makes the dragonfly nymph the apex predator of this tiny ecosystem. While other inhabitants scrape algae or graze on biofilm, this dragonfly nymph lives by stealth, strike, and capture. Most of the time, this jar seems calm, even still. But if you zoom in and speed up the footage 10 times, 25 times, even 100 times, an entirely new world appears. Tiny organisms, almost invisible to the naked eye, dart and drift through the water. At this scale, the ecosystem is buzzing with life. Even the mayfly nymphs reveal another side of their lives. At this speed, you can actually see them chewing away the decaying bogbean leaves, breaking down plant matter and recycling it back into the system. But the surface? The surface tells its own story. It's almost like a separate ecosystem with its own inhabitants and its own dramas. Here, two bladder snails meet, and for a brief moment, there's a little love scene in progress. Bladder snails are hermaphrodites, meaning each one carries both male and female organs, and encounters like this ensure the next generation is never far away. What do you think? Are bladder snails fascinating little pets or just test snails? Discuss below and let me know. And then, among the snails, we find a different kind of inhabitant. Another tiny predator, mosquito larvae. They hang just below the surface, moving in stiff, robotic jerks, feeding on microorganisms and hunting even smaller prey. Mosquito larvae are almost alien in the way they move, dangling from the surface film like little robots, then snapping into motion with a stiff, twitching jerk. They breathe through a siphon at their tail end, which they poke up through the surface tension to take in air. This makes them completely dependent on the surface layer where water meets air. And when it comes to diet, mosquito larvae are filter feeders and scrapers. They sweep tiny brushes around their mouths to pull in microorganisms, bacteria, protozoa, and algae, and bits of organic detritus suspended in the water. In a way, they are recyclers just like the mayfly nymphs and bladder snails, but unlike them, they remain tied to the surface ecosystem. And on larger ponds, the surface isn't only home to larvae. Another iconic inhabitant is the water strider. These insects have legs coated in tiny water-repellent hairs that allow them to skate across the surface tension as if it were solid ground. They are surface hunters, detecting ripples made by struggling insects and darting in to seize them with needle-like mouthparts. Water striders reproduce right there on the surface too. Males court females with tapping vibrations, almost like Morse code, sent through the water film, and the eggs are laid on submerged plants or debris, where the next generation begins. And in case you wondered how this ecosystem is fed, here I'm taking off one of the leaves of the yellow flag iris and I'm just returning it to the little bowl below. And right away, it's not going to be a food source for the animals, but within some days, this will degrade and then all of the animals can start eating it. So the mayfly nymphs, the bladder snails, but also smaller animals we cannot even see, these animals will then feed the predators and then the cycle can continue. If you like this video, please make sure to hit the like button and subscribe to Edgar's Fish Channel. Also, I'm sure you would love this video where I simulated a jungle river tank for 137 days. Or the video on the left-hand side, which is my most recent video. Thanks for watching.